Welcome to First United Methodist Church's worship service. We are a church that strives to know God, love God, and serve God. We are one church with two locations. The Whitmore Lake campus is located at the corner of Main Street and East Shore Drive at 9318 Main Street in Whitmore Lake, Michigan. The Brighton campus is located at the intersection of Brighton Lake Road and Grand River Avenue at 400 East Grand River Avenue in Brighton, Michigan. Please visit us online at brightonfumc.org to learn more, or plan to join us in person at one of our two locations once it is safe to do so. Now, worship is about to begin. We are glad that you are with us.
Good morning. My name is Sherry Parker Lewis. I'm the senior pastor at First United Methodist Church of Brighton in Whitmore Lake, and it is a pleasure to welcome you to worship. It is a great time in the life of our church as we find new and creative ways to stay connected. I want to remind you that at First United Methodist Church, we seek to know God and love God and serve God. And we're doing that in remarkable ways, even if we cannot be face to face this Sunday. I wanted to also let you know that we begin a new worship series today. And so we've been talking about Pastor Bob and I have been talking about what we might do to celebrate you and the faith as we go on to our next appointments in July. And so over these next weeks, Reverend Bob Fuchs, who's the campus pastor at Whitmore Lake campus and also our director of adult discipleship, the two of us are going to be celebrating in these worship series what we love about the faith, what we love about the church, and what we love about you. Get ready for some stories, for some teaching and learning, for song, and for prayer, and for worship. Join me now as we worship.
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters.
He restores my soul.
He restores my soul.
He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake.
Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me.
Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord.
And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
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 Join me in singing What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
To God in prayer. Oh, My name is Marley. Please join me in this morning's opening prayer that will appear on screen. Rejoice in the Lord as always. Again we say rejoice. Dear Lord, we come together to worship, leaving our worries and fears at Jesus' feet. We will praise you in song and listen for you in our prayers. Lord, let this be a time that brings us in peace. Amen. We pray the way of the Lord with worship and praise. Together we worship God.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Mike Tooman, and I'm the worship leader here at the Brighton campus for Brighton First, and I'm trying something a little bit different this morning. I hope you like it. One, two,
pressing on till I see your face. I will live that you will be done, and I won't stop till your kingdom come. 'Cause you are
Good morning. My name is Chris Phillips. I have been asked to spend a little time speaking to the children about prayer. I have been blessed to be a part of Brighton First United Methodist Church's prayer ministry for almost 11 years. The prayer ministry gathers weekly to pray for our church, its members and families, our area, our state, our country, and the world. It turns out that I have a spiritual gift for prayer. Right now, I'm sitting in one of my favorite places in warmer weather, my patio. I love to come out here and hear the birds singing, feel the sun shining, and see the flowers blooming around me. I come here to enjoy nature, read a good book, or just have a little peace. Often when I'm out here, I pray, but this isn't the only place where I pray. I sometimes pray while I'm walking my dog, or I'm driving my car, when I wake up in the middle of the night, while I'm vacuuming the floor, or while I'm reading my email. You get the idea. I pray when I'm happy, sad, afraid, worried, or grateful. I pray for family, friends, and acquaintances, or whatever is on my heart. In the Bible, Mark 11:24 says that whatever we ask in prayer, if we believe that we will receive it, we will. Even though it sounds like I do a lot of talking to God, and I do, one thing I try to do is to listen to what God is trying to tell me and teach me. That isn't always easy for me. Being quiet and listening is when I give God a chance to lead and direct me. I have found that it can be a time of calm and peacefulness, a time of learning about what God wants me to do, rather than me telling God what I would like God to do. We all can pray. Your prayers can follow a pattern that you might have learned, or it can just be a conversation between you and God. Whatever you choose, I encourage you to give it a try. Your prayer doesn't have to be fancy. It just needs to be honest and come from your heart. Will you pray with me? God of love and mercy, please be with us as we bring our joys and concerns to you. We thank you for your son Jesus and his example of praying to you in all things. May we follow his example and bring all things to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Our scripture reading today is from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 9. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Anne. Good morning. My name is Bob Fuchs. I'm the campus pastor at First United Methodist Church's Whitmore Lake campus and the associate pastor at our Brighton campus. Now, when I was growing up, we attended St. Martha's Episcopal Church in Dearborn. And when it was time to pray, we would flip down the kneeler that was attached to the pew in front of us. And we were very careful, though, not to bang it on the floor. And then we would kneel down. We'd fold our hands, we'd bow our head, we'd close our eyes, and we were ready to pray. And we weren't allowed to let our bottoms rest on that pew that was right behind us. We had to sit straight up when we were praying. And for the longest time, that was what I thought it meant to pray. Because see, that's what I was taught, that's what I learned. Now, for the next few weeks, Pastor Sherry and I will be celebrating our time in ministry at First United Methodist Church. And we will be talking about how we've experienced grace through the sacraments, through service, through the blessings that we receive from others, and through the Bible. This morning, we're going to celebrate prayer. Now, as was mentioned earlier, we are a praying community. And if you have a prayer request to share, you can share it right now on the Facebook feed if you're comfortable doing that. Or you can also email it to us at prayers@brightonfumc.org. You can also go to our website and share your prayers there. Now, when I say prayer, what comes to mind for you? Think back. How did you learn about prayer? How did you learn to pray? Now, it may have been a prayer before you went to bed. Now I lay me down to sleep. Some of you know the rest of that. Or maybe you learned to say a prayer at grace. You know, that was what you were doing before you ate a meal. And I'll tell you, at our house, that's a requirement. You don't get away with not saying a prayer before a meal. Now, our kids know this, our grandkids know that, and it doesn't always go as planned, though. When my granddaughter, Allie, when she was really small, she was over for lunch with Sue, her grandmother, and Sue said to her, "Allie, please say grace." And so Allie folded her hands, and she tipped her head down, and she started off with the words that we had taught her, "God is great," and then she continued on with, "Beer is good and people are crazy. Amen." You see, Billy Currington had a song out at that time which had that line in it. And once Sue was able to stop laughing, she said to Allie, "No, not that one, Allie, the other one." And then Allie proceeded to pray. See, we learn how to pray throughout our lives. There are so many ways to pray and so many books and resources on the web available to us. I mean, for example, I mentioned I grew up in the Episcopal Church, and the Episcopal Church publishes this Book of Common Prayer. I want to say, you can see, it's not a little book. This book provides prayers for every occasion, every event in the Christian year, prayers for morning, prayers for evening. The goal this morning, though, is not to talk about here's how you're supposed to pray. I'm not going to teach you how to do that, because quite frankly, we already know how to pray, although we may not realize it. In today's scripture that Anne read from Philippians, we could hear that Paul was associating prayer intimately with that joy, that connection in the Lord. He told the Philippian church to talk to God, listen to this, in every situation by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. See, Paul looked at prayer is that ongoing connection with God, to connect with God in every situation, knowing that God wants to be in relationship with us. So how do we talk to someone that we're in relationship with? How do we talk to someone who's our friend? Well, friends, you see, they want the same things. They're bound by love. The well-being of the one really does connect with what the other wants, the desires. See, friends spend time with each other. They speak openly to each other, fully. They're not afraid to talk with each other. See, friends need each other, and God is not an exception to this rule of friendship. God wants to be in conversation with us. God wants to hear from us. God wants to connect with us. I want you to think about those true friends you have, those people who know you best. When you're facing difficulties or struggling, friends, they often know what we need, even if that need is never voiced, even if we don't know what that need is. And turning to God in prayer, that works the same way. See, even if we can't put it into words, God hears us. Romans 8:26 tells us, "In the same way the Spirit helps us in our weakness, we do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us through wordless groans." See, if we can't find the words to say, the Holy Spirit takes those wordless groans that we're sharing, translate them, and God hears us. But not all prayers are wordless groans. We know that. On Sunday morning, as part of worship, different people will offer prayer. It may be a worship host, maybe one of the pastors, and they spend time in preparing those words to pray on Sunday morning. And when I hear them on countless occasions, I'm moved and I can't believe the impact that they're having on me by that connection they've made. There are other times when I've heard people say, that is exactly the prayer I needed to hear. That's exactly the prayer I wanted to say today. Now, I know a lot of us may be thinking, I can't pray like that. I'm not a good prayer. I'll remind you what I said earlier on. Each of us knows how to pray. Each of us knows how to talk to God, and God hears us. See, prayers don't have to be written ahead of time, and they don't have to be long. They can be short with just a few words. Anne Lamott wrote a book titled Help, Thanks, Wow. Each of those words is a prayer. Think about it. When you're in need or you're struggling, facing a challenge, you can just cry out, help! When giving appreciation for what we've been given, the abundance that each of us has, thanks. And when we see amazing things, hear amazing things, those things that God created, a beautiful song, a sunset, or a newborn baby, wow. You see, you start with one word and go from there. Start that conversation with God. God hears you. Each of us can pray. And when we do, we're following Jesus' example. Throughout his ministry, throughout scripture, we hear about how Jesus prayed, and he was intentional about it. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. That's told to us in Mark chapter 1, verse 35. You see, Jesus is God's son. Spent time with God in prayer. Jesus was in relationship with God. They spoke together. They spent time together. And see, in our current situation that we're in, it's one thing a lot of us do have is time. We're spending time at home. And how much of that time do we turn to God in prayer? It's an opportunity that currently presents itself. You see, our relationship with God and with others is strengthened when we pray. And when we pray for others and they pray for us, there may be a time when you're having difficulty in a relationship and you're not sure what to do. Now, here's an idea. After you get angry, or wait, even better, before you get angry, stop and take time to pray for that person. You may be surprised by the impact that prayer can have on you and on the person you're praying for and how you view them. Mark Wood, one of our fellow worshipers, put it this way. You gain a greater understanding of another person when you pray for them. Imagine taking the time to do that, to gain that understanding, to share in that relationship in a new way. And when we pray for others, that person may not even know the impact that it has on them. Although, listen to these words from Suzanne Everett. She shared this on Facebook this week. There have been times that I've learned others were praying for me, and it was a very powerful, reassuring feeling. It brings me comfort in prayer to visualize God's arms wrapped around me. In this time of physical distancing, we need God's hugs all the more. And I don't know about you, but for me right now, I'm missing that face-to-face physical contact, that connection that we have. See, we've not been able to be together for a rather long time, in my view. And it'd be wonderful to be in that same place, to pray together, because I can't even begin to describe that feeling when someone's wrapped in a prayer quilt like the one behind me, And when we place hands on them and pray over them. This is a photo of Gary Tobel being prayed over when he received his prayer quilt. It's a powerful moment that has an impact on the person receiving those prayers and on those present praying for them. And as a pastor, I felt that connection when I pray with someone before a surgery at the hospital. We're not able to do that right now, but when we are, we'll hold their hand and maybe the hand of a loved one. And on more than one occasion, I can tell you a doctor or a nurse, a tech, someone else from the hospital took part in that prayer. And God comes near and the words just flow. And I know that personally, Sue and I have felt the power of prayer, the love of God and the love of people. When members of First Church prayed over us, when I decided to follow God's call into the ministry. Just because we can't be together right now, that doesn't mean we should stop praying when those occasions present themselves. Thanks to technology, we can pray with someone over the phone or on video chats, and we know that God is present and God hears us. You see, prayer can happen anywhere, and we don't know when that moment will strike us. Early one morning, a few years ago, I was out for a jog in the neighborhood, and then suddenly I just felt this urgent need to stop. Stop right where I was, get on my knees and pray. Now, I remember the moment, but I can't even tell you what it was I prayed for or about. I just know that I had to stop right then and there, and I had to pray. I'm thankful there wasn't a lot of traffic that morning and that God kept me safe. See, no matter where you are, it's a good place to pray. Now, I am going to give some practical advice when I say you can pray anywhere. When you are driving, please keep your eyes on the road and your hands on the wheel while you pray. See, God hears even our open-eyed prayers. God hears us if our hands aren't folded or our head isn't bowed. There is no place on this earth where we should not pray. See, no matter where we are, at home, out and about, God hears us. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 18, it tells us this: rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Pray continually. What does that mean? We had a chance to talk about that at our staff meeting via Zoom earlier this week. It was a question we discussed. And I took some notes and I let everyone know that they were helping me write this sermon. Here's what our music director, Susan Snow, had to say. God is always in your head, always with you. Throughout the day, when you think of someone, pray for them. When you hear a siren off in the distance, say a prayer. When something on the news makes you smile or upsets you, say a prayer. When you wake up in the morning, before you go to bed, open and close your day with prayer, connecting with God. Karen Wagg, she said this, our office assistant, she said, prayer happens whether you recognize it or not. Life is a prayer. You see, praying doesn't interfere with your day. It makes your day. It makes God's day. Every time we pray, no matter the hour or the day, God hears us. See, God hears us because God is in relationship with us. When we take time to talk with Jesus, the impact on us and others is powerful. Whatever the conversation, asking for healing, praying for someone else, giving thanks for a meal. See, there is nothing in our lives that God doesn't want to hear about. And if we make a mistake during our prayer, or we pray, heaven forbid, for the wrong thing, it's okay. You see, God can take our weakest prayers, our most broken prayers, and use those for good. God hears us. I'll tell you, right now it seems like we have a lot more reasons to pray than we did just a few months ago. We're experiencing loneliness, isolation. There's that absence of human connection, and we are experiencing fear. See, during these challenging times, anxiety and worry can spread. I was on a conversation with Pastor Sherry earlier this week. We were on our phones, and she put it this way when we were talking about this. Prayer is the antibody of worry. That was echoed in a resource that I use called Preaching Through the Christian Year. It put it this way, and this is before the current pandemic. Prayer is the antidote to anxiety. Now, right now, I know we can all use more antibodies and antidotes. And this one, prayer, is available to everyone at all times. Now, I want you to grab a pen and write down these scriptures. I'll give you a moment to do that. Okay, got something to write with? Here we go. Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 through 34, and Luke chapter 12, verses 22 through 34. I hope you find time to read those and hear what Jesus is saying. I'll give you the Cliff Notes version. You see, God does not want us to worry, although worry is something we're really, really, really good at. And during these times of uncertainty, we can feel overwhelmed. And turning to prayer, knowing that God hears us, will help us move from worry and anxiety to peace, hope, and trust in God. I love the way the Message worded the second half of Philippians 4, verse 7 from today's reading. It's wonderful what happens when Christ displaces worry at the center of your life. When Christ displaces worry at the center of your life. Prayer is that vital connection. Anytime, anywhere, with one word or many, out loud or in your mind, standing with your hands raised, or kneeling with your hands folded, your head bowed, and your eyes closed. Go to God in prayer. God hears, God loves, and God does not social distance ever. Throw all your anxiety onto Him because He cares about you. I added that scripture from 1 Peter. It's from chapter 5, verse 7. I added it to my email signature line a few weeks ago to serve as a reminder for me and those that are receiving emails from me. And I leave it as the reminder for us this morning. And I pray for each of us that Jesus will displace that anxiety we are experiencing and give us peace. Thanks be to God. Amen.
To survive, I get when I feel there's a need to talk with God, He is Emmanuel. I close my eyes, no darkness there. There's only light. I get on my knees. I get on my knees.
Good morning. It's time for prayer, and I thought that because we're talking about prayer today, that we might try something a little bit different. So we're going to do a directional prayer. So I invite you to stand. Now, you may have a pet in your lap that's all cozy and warm, and so you don't have to stand. But if you're able, I invite you to stand up for this prayer because we're going to be praying directionally. Now, I am standing in the middle of the cul-de-sac that's in front of our house, and right now I am facing west. And so I invite you to find the place where you can stand, where you'll be facing west. You may have to consult with someone about what that direction is, and if you don't know, that's okay. Just take your best guess. It's generally where that afternoon sunlight's coming in. So you wanna look at the sun part of the afternoon. So find that place, and you're good. So we're gonna begin praying by standing and looking to the west. And through this, I'm going to invite you to turn and to look in different directions. And so let's begin in prayer. Gracious and loving God, it is so good to be able to say, in all times and in all circumstances, you got this. We are grateful for your creating and sustaining presence by your Spirit, and we are grateful for the risen Christ, your Son. We're grateful for a life that is abundant in you, and that you are our source of hope and of peace. And so now, as we face west, we offer in prayer our neighbors, those who are to the west, those we know by name and those we don't. We ask that you might encircle them in your care this week. We also pray for you, for those who are struggling in this direction. We pray for sister areas and cities, and we pray for those who are working to be essential in this time, whether it's grocery workers or first responders or medical care people, and all those who are working, that you might be with them. Lord, as we face this direction, we remember your life-giving presence in the sun that crosses the sky, in the moon that stands to light our waves, and in all the ways that you can continue to create in this world. And now we're going to move, and we're going to be facing south. So go ahead and just turn in some way and find yourself facing south. And let's pray. Lord, As we face south, we are mindful of those who are not well. Perhaps they have a virus, and perhaps it's other struggles, even chronic pain, and those who are struggling in the midst of this time with addictions and mental illness. And we ask that you might care for them. As we face this way, we pray for our neighbors who live in this direction. We pray for all school children who are learning a new way to be in school, and for educators who have had often a sharp learning curve, that in this you might continue to connect them in community and in opportunities for learning. We are so thankful, Lord, for the abundance that we have received, for how you care for us even in our homes day by day. And we give you thanks for the most simple of wonders that you offer through spring, through the gifts of life, even through the water that flows through our taps. We are thankful. Now we're going to move, and we're going to be facing east. And so as we face east, we can be mindful of that rising sun and the gifts of God that it promises. Let us pray. Lord, as we face east, we pray in this time for leaders in our community, in our state, and in our nation. We ask that by your guiding hand, good decisions will be made on our behalf and on behalf of this nation and this world. We pray for those who are fearful around the world. And we pray for those who are working hard to bring calm and peace. Oh Lord, we know that leaning on you is a place of hope, and we pray that hope for this world in this difficult time, trusting always that you hear our cries. And now, I stand facing north. I invite you to turn and face the north. And behind me is the parsonage. And so we'll take a few moments to just pray a blessing on neighbors and pray a blessing on our own homes. Lord, for our neighbors, those that live to the west and to the south and to the north and to the east, that you might bless them. Whether we can name them or not, we lift them to you. And Lord, as we stand here in our homes, maybe even in front of our homes, that you might bless those places, make them a haven of peace and rest, make them a place of productivity and community and connection. And Lord, we ask that for our loved ones who are in other places, maybe even places we won't be able to travel to for a while, that their homes may be blessed as well. And Lord, fill us now with your Spirit. Empower us to ways of praying that we have not experienced us. Lead us to places where we can be deeply connected to you. And in that way, Lord, shape us so that we might be deeply connected and serve your community and your world. We are so thankful for the gift of prayer. And now we remember that gift of prayer as we remember the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God's blessings. Let's pray together.
Good morning. My name is Bill Draving, and I would like to talk about what prayer means to me. My first memories of prayer are with my mom and my dad teaching me and my brothers how to pray. And they didn't really teach us by telling us. They taught us more by teaching us by showing us. I remember them praying before we ate. I remember them praying in good times. I remember them praying in bad times. And I remember them praying before our trips in the car. To this day, when we go back to visit, before we leave, they will say a prayer for our traveling mercies for us. And one of the things I've learned about prayer is that it's like a lot of things in life. The more you do it, the better you become at it. I believe our prayer lives will be unique because you look at your relationship with God, and that's what prayer is having a relationship with God. It is unique. It's not the same between any two people. Being in a dark, quiet place may work for some people, but at other times, lately, my praying place that I have is running with my dog in the woods and just being at peace with God there, because when I'm out in nature, it's easy for me to connect with God because I look around, I see his handiwork all over the place. And I just know that I'm able to find prayer there much easier. And prayer during this time has given me peace over things that I cannot control. Looking back, it was through prayer that I got the courage to start leading my very first mission. And the missions I like to work with are with the homeless people. Many years back, I was working with a youth group in Redford, and I was wondering about how to make an impact in their lives. And they're asking about the poverty in Detroit and what could we do about it. And so we prayed. And just the very next day, the pastor approached me with a ministry called NOAA. I had never organized a group at church before, and I was just 100% sure this was going to end in a mess and that people were not going to get fed. But I prayed, and things just started happening and coming together. And prayer is a way of relieving stress and pressure in my life because it helps me connect with God. And when you get that connection with God, it shows you that your life is bigger than just your own life, the way you connect with people. And prayer gives me the courage to stand up in front of people and talk about prayer. Is that ironic? I don't know. It's just a fact. My prayer life is not always set in a routine because when you have a family, life happens. Prayer will be finding that quiet time in all the chaos of life when you can connect with God. So this is a spot in a service where we would normally take up an offering. And in order to make the Lord's will be done on earth as it is in heaven, requires us to pray, and it also requires us to give thanks to God through our offerings. I mean, God has given us resources, but not endless resources. So we have to be good stewards with what we have, which is the reason that my family gives to Brighton First United Methodist Church, because we know where that money goes when it's donated. I love that we have a Christian preschool inside our building. So when we make improvements to the building, we're furthering that ministry. We even have volunteer labor through Men with Tools to help ensure our gifts are maximized. Of course, our gifts don't just stay inside the building. I mean, right next door to our church is Vina. That's a ministry we all should be bragging about every single day. This last week, we delivered food down to Cass Community Church to help people during this pandemic because people still have to eat. Many of you have helped make lunches during the services for delivery down to Central as part of the NOAA program. And then we have UMCOR, United Methodist Coalition on Relief, which helps after natural disasters. And one of the things I love about UMCOR is that as soon as they allow relief organizations in, UMCOR will be there. You can go to the church website at brightonfumc.org, click on the link on the front page for more information about giving. Our theme today has been about prayer, and this leads perfectly into our last song. I get the most out of worship through music, whether it was at a Christian rock concert or Spring Hill, and I always wanted to feel that in my home church, and so I prayed. And I'm feeling my prayers have been answered with the music we have here at Brighton First United Methodist, because When you go to our church or you just visit through our webcast, you've experienced the awesome music and singing talent that we have. And I know God has given everyone gifts, but what I like is when people have gifts that I don't have and they share them, and it just glorifies God so much more. And it is that way with music to me. As anyone that's heard me sing knows that I God did not give that talent to me. And yet, I'm able to experience worship through the talent of others as an answer to my prayer. So worship and sing with me as we sing our final song here, Let Our Faith Become a Mountain.
Hello, my name is Eric Harp, and I'm the worship leader for the Whitmore Lake Campus. And before I get going with this next song, I just want to share that in spite of everything that's going on, I still really do feel blessed that we are able to stay connected with each other and join together to experience this worship as one church. And with that being said, this next song is called Let Our Faith Become a Mountain.
No more worry, no more fear. As we come to the end of this morning's worship service, I wanted to take some time with you while I'm taking a short walk. We've talked about prayer this morning, and in my hand, I'm holding a holding cross. That's what it's called. It's a holding cross. It's made out of olive wood, and I hold it sometimes when I'm praying. It helps ground me and center me. Now, as I'm walking, you may hear some birds in the background. You may hear some traffic. You may even see one of my neighbors. And you know what? It's a wonderful thing to be able to be outside as the weather is getting warmer. And ordinarily, as I give this benediction, this sending forth, we'd be going out into the world. Well, that's a little bit challenging right now. However, you can go out into the world in so many different ways and have an impact. And even if you can't, you can pray. And I pray for you this week. I pray that the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, may guide your hearts and minds. Be at peace this week. Be in prayer. In our amazing Savior's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. my son Garrett, and he's going to help me out on bass, and we're going to play a song called I Will Follow.
Chris, and this is Kate, and we're going to sing a song called Oh My Soul by Casting Crowns.
Someday it all works out, 'cause this is the value.
We are so glad you worshiped with us. We are a church that strives to know God, love God, and serve God. You are invited to take part in this mission by worshiping, joining one or more small groups, sharing prayer requests, and becoming part of our community. We are one church with two locations. The Whitmore Lake campus is located at the corner of Main Street and East Shore Drive at 9318 Main Street in Whitmore Lake, Michigan. The Brighton campus is located at the intersection of Brighton Lake Road and Grand River Avenue at 400 East Grand River Avenue in Brighton, Michigan. Please visit us online at brightonfumc.org to learn more or plan to visit us in person at one of our two locations once it is safe to do so. We hope you were blessed by this worship. Please click the like button, subscribe to our channel, share this video, and join us again next week.